Hi, I'm Kara Price, and this is Talk Nerdy to Me, the HuffPost science show in which we boldly go where scientists have gone before.
If you follow science news, you might be under the impression that bees are dying out.
Honeybees now in danger of disappearing.
They are dying off at an alarming rate.
Our bees were just destroyed in a couple of weeks.
And bees are in danger.
That may worry you because you know that bees make delicious honey, and you love delicious honey. But it also may worry you because bees are an integral part of our agricultural system. So no bees means no food for us, but also we don't want an entire species to drop dead. Fear not. One scientist believes solutions can be found by bee hunting.
Before humans were beekeepers, they were bee hunters. Hunter-gatherer people today are bee hunters. So we know it goes back 100, 150,000 years. As long as people have been humans, probably they've been bee hunting.
Bee hunting?
This is actually a pretty cool activity. It takes advantage of the communication ability of honeybees that you can introduce one bee to a rich food source. She will load up and she'll go home and she'll bring other bees to that same food source. You then can develop enough traffic between your little food source and their nest. You can actually sight them as they fly off. You see enough flight activity. You can see what direction they're going. You can work your way down that, what we call the bee line, the flight line home. It's a form of treasure hunting, natural treasure hunting. It's remarkable that this is being done by these insects where it might be a half a mile or a mile away back to their nests, but they're able to direct them out to your little feeder.
How is hunting bees in the wild going to help bees in managed colonies?
I got interested in studying these wild colonies of honeybees as opposed to the managed colonies kept by beekeepers because my primary interest with the bees is understanding their biology. Whenever you study the biology of any organism, you really want to know how that animal lives under natural conditions. I needed to understand how honeybees build their nests in the wild, how they forage in the wild, how they deal with diseases, predators, because all of those things are different when they're living on their own.
In the past two decades, managed bee populations have been devastated by mites and viruses.
The honeybee colonies are still living in the wild as well as they were back in the 1970s. How is it that these colonies living in the wild can stay healthy without any treatments, whereas the colonies that are managed by beekeepers have great difficulty and most would die within a few years without being treated? In the wild, the colonies did suffer heavy mortality initially. The population of wild colonies went through a crash. There was very strong selection on those colonies, and only the colonies that were resistant to the viruses survived. And they're able to exist on their own to deal with these mites and the viruses. And we know that because we're able to look at the genetics and compare the genetics of the wild colonies with the managed colonies, and they're very, very different.
The crucial difference between managed and wild bee populations is ultimately space. It's like the difference between living in Manhattan and Montana.
In the wild, they're on average about a half a mile apart. In a beekeeper's bee yard, they're on average a few feet apart. That means that in a beekeeper's colony, the stage is set for that pathogen and parasite to evolve virulence. If a very virulent strain develops, it will kill its host, but it doesn't kill itself because there is another host that it can infect right next door. Now, out in the woods, the situation's different because with the colonies that far apart, there are not bees drifting from the colony in this tree over to a tree that's a half mile away. In the natural situation, there's actually selection against virulent strains of the viruses because if you're a very virulent strain and you kill your host, you have also killed yourself. Once we find out what has changed in terms of the bees' genetics that gives them resistance to the mites and the viruses, that will actually guide our understanding of what we can select for and breed for in managed colonies of bees.
So if bees are doing better in the wild, why are we messing with them? And should we stop?
The message from this is not going to be, oh, let the bees live the way they are. We depend too heavily on honeybees, managed colonies of honeybees. And I'm not referring to their production of honey. That's almost incidental. Their main value is for pollination purposes. Currently, we need about 3 million colonies of bees just to meet the pollination needs within the United States.
Each colony has about 40,000 bees. That's thousands of bees needed for every American.
If you look at the list of 100 plants that produce food for humans, the top 100, 70 of those require pollination by an insect. The way we humans are, the numbers we have on the planet now, we have to be very, very efficient with the agriculture, and honeybees are part of that.
Is there hope for managed bees? Are they all going to die off from viruses and mites?
The optimist would say, well, look at what happened with humans. You know, people had to deal with these problems when humans evolved cities, and you know, there were huge matters of public health and disease, and humans have been able to solve those problems to a large extent. It's always going to be a problem when organisms live close together, and we humans have done pretty well. The message that will emerge from this is the rethink of some of our beekeeping practices so that we can take better care of the bees that are under our management, learning some lessons from the wild.
Hunting for wild bees may sound like child's play, but what Tom Seeley has learned about honeybees gives us tremendous insight into improving their management so that they can continue to pollinate our crops. Because without them, our modern agricultural industry would eventually collapse.